Christian love, the fellowship of kindred minds, is nigh to that above.
Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2. We're going to start with verse 15. Our Christmas carol, O Little Town of Bethlehem, speaks to our heart today when it begins by saying, cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. That is the message of Christmas, that we can rely upon the birth of Christ as our Savior. The message of Christmas is found in two important facts. First of all, the name of the Savior. Luke chapter 1, verse 31 says, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. Now that name Jesus in the Greek is Jesus, Jesus. And it means that he is the Savior. He's come to save us of our sins. In the Hebrew, it is Yeshua, which means Jehovah's salvation. And beloved, from the very beginning, as I shared this morning, all the way from the Garden of Eden to that moment there in Bethlehem, everything had plummeted towards that point. Everything was directed. Every concept, every nation, every decision was all pointing towards this baby being born in a manger, there in Bethlehem, walking the roads headed towards Calvary to die for our sins. So we see not only the name of our Savior, but we also note in Luke chapter 1, verse 35, his nature. And the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. This is not just another baby born that day. Though as small as Bethlehem was, I doubt if there were a lot of children born that night. Even though 2 years later, Herod said, I want you to kill every child, male child, 2 years and under. A lot of children were born in those 2 years, obviously. But that night, there was just one, and he was the Savior of the world. We're going to take a look again at the shepherds, how they came to Bethlehem, how they responded, and how they left. Let's start with verse 15 and 16. We're going to see the response to their experience. Starting with verse 15, so it was when the angels had gone away from them into heaven that the shepherds said to one another, let us now go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Now when they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. We see in verse 15 the resolve of the shepherds. Once you hear about Jesus, once you are confronted with the fact of not only his birth, but his reason for being here, his sacrifice, his atonement, it demands a response. And the response of the shepherds was simple. It was an encounter with Jesus, and it was going to demand, there was a necessity for a decision on their part. We see a desire of opportunity here in verse 15. There was a heart that they had for Jesus. They had not met him. They had not seen him. But yet, because the great witness, and that's, by the way, what the word angel means, messenger. And by the great witness that came among them and told them glorious things that happened that night, they had a heart for Jesus. Oh, folks, there are people who we share the good news with. Every day, different places where we work, places where we go to shop, places all around, perhaps at school or whatever. These are places that we share Jesus with people, and lo and behold, they have to make a decision. And I have been in situations where people have made decisions to the contrary. I want nothing to do with him. I've had people say that to me. I've had people who I've shared the word of God with. Deborah and I, years ago, had a gentleman that we went to school with, began to share the word of God with him. And every time I said to him, but the Bible says, he'd begin to curse. I mean, it was just every time. Now, how do you witness someone without quoting Bible? It's kind of difficult. And every time we'd bring the Bible up, he'd begin to swear. That blankety-blank book or that blankety-blank. It was unbelievable. But he made a decision that day. I never saw him again. He made a decision that day. I hope it was seed sown in good ground. I pray that this gentleman had an opportunity later on in life to receive Christ. I don't have that guarantee. The shepherds had a choice that night. They had a decision to make. When you have an encounter with the glorious, when you have an encounter with the news of Jesus, you have a decision whether it be to reject or receive. That is the nature of Christmas. Either you believe or you don't believe. Either you believe in Christmas or you just want to go your route as a secular atheist or whatever. The fool in his heart said there is no God. And as we share Christmas with others, we note their foolish resentment as we begin to share them the good news. So these shepherds had a heart for Jesus. And folks, listen, if people don't have a heart for Jesus, they'll reject him. And is that some form of predestination that God has preordained some men and women, boys and girls to be saved, and over here's another opportunity? They are predestined to be lost forever. Now, folks, that's not the way it works. You see, the omniscience of God has come to this world. The Bible says it has come to the world, for God so loved the world that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. So what we must understand, the message is for whosoever, but in his foreknowledge, in his omniscience, he knows who will receive and who will reject. I believe that's why the angels came to those shepherds that night, there in the land of Judah, there in the fields of Boaz, because they had a heart for Jesus. Now, the question is obvious at this point in time for you and me. What do we have a heart for? What is that that drives us? What is that that causes us and desires for us to do all that we do? Oh, we might say, I would like to think that I have a heart for Jesus. But there are people who do not, beloved. And so we must be careful in that. And then not only did they have a heart for Jesus, but they had a heart full of joy. When you come in the presence of that which is godly, that which is holy, that which was speaking the truth, the angels were reciting, literally reciting the word of God in its pre-form. And when it was written down and canonized as scripture, they were literally embellished into the word of God. That word, folks, fills our heart with joy. Now, I've met people all my life who've been convicted. And I've met people who say, you're making me feel guilty. Why are you doing this to me? You're trying to make me feel guilty. When in reality, I like to share with them, you're blaming the wrong person. That's the Holy Spirit's prompting. That's called conviction. Guilt comes from you. Well, I want to do what I want to do. That's not my problem. I didn't say that about you. That's what the Holy Spirit put on your heart. But you don't know. I don't know. It's none of my business. I don't want to know. But the Holy Spirit convicted your heart. Now, when the Holy Spirit convicts your heart, you have a choice. You have a decision. You either say yes to the prompting of the Holy Spirit, or you reject the prompting of the Holy Spirit. The shepherds received the word with joy. And the Bible says their hearts were filled with joy heading towards Bethlehem. Let us go see this place, the Bible says. See these things that have come to pass, which the Lord has made known to us. Too many people today have a hard heart. I don't know about you, but I have noticed that the older I get. And I don't think it's just a phenomenon because I'm getting older. I think it's a phenomenon. It's what's happening in our world, in our culture, in our society today. People's hearts become harder and harder and harder. And the reason why is that simple. They need an encounter with Jesus. They honestly do, folks. And how can they have that encounter? They're not going to have angels opening the skies and singing aloud and all this fanfare. You and I are the ones to bring the great story of Christmas. That's why you and I, of all people, when we're walking along and shuffling through life and during this time of Christmas, we ought to have joy in our heart. We ought to have the joy of the thanksgiving of what Christ has done for us. I know, I'm like you. I get caught up in the tinsel and the trinkets and the toys and all those different things. And you look at all the different things and say, oh my, I'm just overwhelmed by this. But see, the shepherds had that joy in their heart. And the people listened to them later, did they not? Because you see, if we tried to convince people that Jesus is wonderful and our heart is not filled with joy, how are they going to believe us? How are they going to believe us? We see a desire of opportunity. We see a decision for obedience. Look at their direct obedience. They left immediately, did they not? The Bible says in verse 16, and they came with haste. They came with haste. They had a direct obedience and they had a directional obedience. They quickly went to where Jesus was. They didn't say, Jesus is born in Bethlehem. I'm heading to Nablus. I'm out of here. Going to Nazareth. Nope. They said, let's go see this which has been told of us. And they went directly to Jesus. Now, folks, let me say this to you. If you want to have joy in your life, you really want to have joy in your life, find out where Jesus is and head there. There are too many people today that have no joy in their heart. They have no joy in their life because they're not walking with the Lord. Now, understand this, Christians, we too can be robbed of the joy we have. In fact, Paul tells us we have to be careful lest anyone rob us. And so what we need to have when we do lose our joy, when we have the world enclosed in on us, what do? We go find where Jesus is and we stay there with him. The bottom line is simple. We need a fresh encounter with the Lord. There are a lot of people that use different terminologies for that. One of the ones that most Bible students use, they call it, I'm just going and rededicating my life to the Lord. I've seen people come to this altar full of sadness and sorrow, their hearts embittered by the things of this world. I've seen people, Christians especially, whose lives have been inundated with the things of this world, and they have become embittered by the decisions they make. And they've come down to this altar, had a fresh encounter with Jesus. I'm not talking about being born again, Christian. I'm talking about having a fresh encounter with Jesus, laying those problems, confessing our sins, laying those problems at the cross, and leaving with the joy of Christ in our heart. Well, what will they think of me? Folks, if I were you, I wouldn't care what they thought of me. I'd care what Jesus thought of me. You see, the shepherds, they wanted to be where Jesus was. And so here's the question. Are we, like the shepherds, willing to follow Jesus today, no matter what the cost? No matter what it's going to cost us. We say, well, there's no joy in my life. My family, there's no joy. I've got this and that. Listen, folks. Joy is not in your family. Joy is not in your spouse. Joy is not in your children or in your grandchildren. Oh, those are things that can bring great happiness to you. But your true joy is in Jesus. And then all these things fall in place, do they not? You see, all these things can be taken from us. All these things that we think we have joy in, can be removed in our life. Whether it be a child, a husband, a wife, whether it be a friend, a job, a car, a home. All these things can be removed in a moment's notice. But Jesus said, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. The shepherds had a visitation of the holy. They had a visitation from God. And their hearts were filled with joy. And they said, let's go to this place. So we see the resolve of the shepherds. Verse 16, we see the recognition of the shepherds. In verse 16, the Bible says, and they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph. We see they found the witnesses. You see, Mary and Joseph were partners of this moment. Christmas was not about Mary and Joseph. Christmas is not about the Virgin of Nazareth. It's not about the carpenter of Nazareth. They were good people. God separated them, set them apart because they were good people. They were the right family. They were born in the right lineage. They had the right spirit. They had the right heart. But that's not what Christmas was about. Christmas was not about Mary or Joseph. They were only witnesses, much like the shepherds. They were participants of this miracle. Both Mary and Joseph were willing participants in this Christmas pageant. Why were they willing participants? Because they were willing to say yes to God. Then the shepherds came and they found the wonder. The Bible says in verse 16, and the babe lying in a manger. Excuse me. Notice they didn't say that they found the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes. You see, that wasn't the sign. The sign was the manger. Babies were swaddled from time immemorial. Those were things they did to help that child feel that closeness of the womb and that warmth of being wrapped up. But the manger, different story. Who puts a baby in a feed trough? That was the interesting thing. You see, that was the sign of the manger. And why a manger? Why not a rock place? Why not a shelf on it? Why not a drawer in a hotel? The bottom line was simple. Because the manger was for the Lamb of God. We see the sign of the manger. We see the Savior of mankind. Luke 2:11 says, for there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. He was the Savior. He was born that day, set apart for mankind. The Lamb of God, and John introduced him. John the Baptist introduced him in John 1:29 as, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We have a Lamb of God born in a cave, there in a place where animals were at, placed in a manger so that shepherds could come and view and see and rejoice about the Lamb of God who came to take away the sins of the world. We note the response to their experience. In verse 17 through 20, we see the results of their encounter. It gave them a message. Look at verse 17 and 18. And when they had seen him, notice that. When they had seen him, they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. Those who encountered the Savior, they encountered the Messiah. The one the great prophets spoke about. The one the scriptures foretold would come. Oh, they many times had sat around the campfires. Many times when the Greeks had been there hundreds of years before, the shepherds and the people of the fields were all talking about the coming of the Messiah. But then when the Romans came in, the message didn't change. Oh, I wonder when the Messiah is coming. You see, they wanted a return to the kingdom of God. They wanted to return to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. They wanted to take that opportunity to say, David's line is once more on the throne. We see their encounter with the Messiah, And look also in verse 17, the evangelism of the men. The Bible says, and they made widely known the saying which was told them concerning this child. Can I put it in our vernacular? They couldn't shut up talking about it. Every person they saw. What is this? What do you keep talking about this baby? A baby's a baby, for goodness sake. Oy vey, the baby again. What's going on? This was the Messiah. They could not keep the message in their heart. You see, when you meet Jesus, you want to share him with others, don't you? Especially family. Someone you love, friends. Somebody who cares. Folks, listen, the Bible says in 1 John, who hath the Son hath life, and who hath not the Son hath not life. And so what we understand, folks, if we do not share Jesus with those we meet, who will? Who will? Verse 18, we see those who encountered the shepherds. How did they react? And all those who heard it marveled at those things which were told them by the shepherds. We're so afraid they're going to reject this. Oh, they'll leave me. They'll walk away. They'll make fun of me. Some will. But there will be those who marvel. Why? Because it's a message worth hearing. What are the messages there? Well, we talk about a lot of things, and I'm included. We talk about the weather. Indiana, all you got to do is wait around. Your subject will change in a few minutes. Then what we also understand, that lo and behold, sports, same way. Just when you got your team going and everything, something happens, and there it goes. What is the most important message for us today? I think the underlying message that the world needs to hear is simple. He died for us that we might live. Every time I go to a funeral home, folks, it breaks my heart to see that death has caused a family grief. Jesus came into this world not only as the Lamb of God who came to die for our sins, but he rose from the dead that you and I would have the hope eternal of life beyond the grave. And that is a message worth hearing. That is a message worth hailing. And that is a message worth heeding. The shepherds changed their occupations from full-time shepherds to full-time ambassadors for Christ. Oh, they still herded sheep. They still smelt like woolies. They still were made fun of by people saying, hey, there's some little sheep herders, you know. Wish they'd take a bath or something, you know. Oh, but you see, they had a new occupation. They were now ambassadors of the eternal. When we have an encounter with Jesus, we're changed. Things are different. It's not like it used to be. Our life will never be the same. I was an 11-year-old boy. I don't know what the Lord saved me from. I have no doubt. I know what the Lord saved me for. And I'm very happy and very pleased that my life has gone the way. I wish I'd changed things. There's, just like you, there are things I wish I'd have changed here or there, tweaked here or there. But, you know, by and large, the Lord has given me a good life. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. Oh, you have an occupation outside of this church. Many of you have worked many hard years. Some of you have retired. Some of you have wished you retired. Some of you who've retired wish the others who haven't retired knew they don't need to retire, right? The bottom line is simple, folks. We're still all ambassadors for Christ. God has not changed. The shepherds went everywhere. They told everyone. And that is the message of Christmas. Oh, listen, folks, it breaks my heart to see people shopping and look at them and wonder, do you really know the truth of Christmas? In verse 19 and 20, we see not only did it give them a message, but it gave them a mandate. Look at verse 19, the pondering of the mother. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. Now later on, Mary begins to share about Jesus there at the first miracle, if you remember the story. They ran out of wine, and someone said, hey, Mary, because many people believe it was one of her children's wedding. We got a problem here. We need to, find somebody to go out and get us something to drink here. What's going on? The wedding's not going to go on. It's going to be a great tragedy. She said, you go to Jesus. Do whatever he tells you. See, she pondered these things in her heart for a moment, but she shared them with others. And Mary was pondering what she could share. Sometimes we have to sit and wait and grasp a hold of what this thing has done for us, and to really understand what Christ has done for you. I know people who go off like a Roman candle. After they're saved, they're like a big firecracker. Boom, they go off like a shoof, and then pow, and then you never see them again. What happened, you might ask? They didn't ponder the things in the heart. They didn't establish a foundation that they needed with Jesus. Well, every time Mary held Jesus in her arms, she thought of these things. I love that song by Mark Lowry, Mary, Did You Know? That you were looking in the face of God. Every time you kissed your baby, you kissed the face of God. Every time Mary held Jesus in her arms, every time she wiped off the little boo-boo and did all the things that little babies and infants and toddlers do, she remembered the stories of the angels and the shepherds, excuse me, and eventually the wise men. The thoughts of Mary's heart was the thoughts of Jesus. And that's what they ought to be in ours. You know, the moment we were saved, we began to ponder the things of Jesus. But what happened? Many times this world comes into our life and snuffs out the candle, puts out the embers. My pastor used to say this. He said his father took him to an old stove. Now, many of you perhaps have never seen a coal stove before. I remember my grandparents having a coal stove in both of their homes. I remember waking up early morning, hearing my grandfather getting the stove ready, opening up and with that shovel and pulling out the ashes and putting the coal in and getting things ready. And lo and behold, what I noticed was that the embers, you could take two embers, and if you separated them, they became cold-looking, and they didn't glow like they used to. But the moment you put it back together, that one that grew cold would grow strong again and light up. You see, Mary pondered these things in her heart so she could remain close to Jesus. And many times the world closes out that. Many times the world causes us to lose our perspective on pondering Jesus in our life. Oh, folks, all it takes is one thought. Where would I be without Jesus today? Where would your home be? Where would your family be? Where would your life be? What would you be doing tonight? We see the thoughts of Mary's heart. Colossians 3:2 says this, set your mind on things above, not on things of the earth. Oh, folks, don't let the glitz and glitter and all the glamour of this world steal your heart. Oh, the world can do it bigger and better when it comes to entertainment. I've gone to churches where they've had all these great entertainment things. One year in First Church, we brought Disney in and had them design all our stuff to go on our platform for our Christmas. It was unbelievable. Thousands of dollars. Unbelievable what we paid for it. But it was absolutely gorgeous. And the world can do it bigger and better. Oh, folks, it's not in the trinkets. It's not in the trappings that we put around our lives. It's not in the things we think we need, the things we ought to have. It's in one person, Jesus. We see the thoughts of Mary's heart, but we see the treasure of Mary's heart. In NIV, the Bible says, but Mary treasured up all these things. What's the treasure in your heart today? What truly is the most important thing? If your house was burning right now, what would you go in to get? Would your life be ruined? Would your life be over? You see, the tragedy truthfully is, where is our heart? Matthew 6:21 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Oh, folks, listen, it only takes but a couple of minutes to find out where your treasure's at. All it takes is just a spark somewhere, or a wreck of a car, or a loss of a job, or bad health, and you will see where your joy is at. Is Jesus your treasure? As for Mary, it was hers. Finally, we see in verse 20 the praise of the men. We see the pondering of Mary, but look at the praise of the men in verse 20. Then the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. Christmas really is a time for worship. Really, it is. We have secularized Christmas so much. That's why I'm so glad we had our birthday parties for Jesus next door. I've had people say, well, you know, that's secular. No, it's not secularizing. When you're trying to literally teach our children the most important thing of Christmas, you do. And you see, you ought to teach the most important thing. It's all right to have tinsel. It's all right to have Christmas trees. Don't grab your tree tonight. Take it out back and set it on fire, please. My pastor told me to do this. No, I'm not saying that. Nothing wrong with tinsel. Nothing wrong with wreaths. Nothing wrong with candles. Nothing wrong with all the trappings and the gifts. Folks, it's what we do with them and we make of it. When that becomes the prominent thing of our Christmas, then we have made the wrong decision. They went back praising God because Christmas is a time of worship. Personalize the Christmas story, as Yoda would say, they did. Receive Christ, treasure him up in your heart. Live Christmas every day of your life. Let the people see the difference. There's too many people in darkness. Christmas is also a time of wonder. Look at verse 20 again. The Bible says, and all the things they had heard and seen as it was told them. Folks, listen. There's some beautiful things. I don't know. You might think of whatever is in your mind about what you have seen in your life that was the most awe-inspiring, beautiful scene or time you've ever seen before. It might be as simple as a sunset on the ocean or a sunrise on the ocean. I've been fortunate to see both of them. They're gorgeous, are they not? It might be I've seen the sunrise on the Sea of Galilee. There I was in slumber and sleeping there in Galilee. What a wonderful time, dreaming about all kinds of good things. And there I am up on the seventh floor, hearing a tapping on my window. Lo, as I looked out the window, there appeared a cane sticking around the corner with the hand of my father-in-law on the other end. Cracked the window. The sun's coming up. The sun's coming up. And I said, and it'll set tonight too. But I watched the sunrise in Galilee. It was a gorgeous, beautiful, beautiful view. I'm glad I got up. I'm glad he decided to tap on my window. But the bottom line is simple. All these things will pass away. Only Jesus will last forever. only Jesus. When all the toys are out from underneath the tree, when the last bulb is taken off and put away to be stored for another year, when all the songs and the records and the CDs and all of those things are put away for next year, Jesus is still there. And that was the joy of Christmas. That in itself is what the shepherd found that day. It didn't say how much time they spent in the cave. And the reason for that, I believe, is when you're in the presence of Jesus, time is not an issue. It's a lifelong adventure. I didn't receive Christ as an 11-year-old boy and said, "Thank you, Jesus. I appreciate the salvation. I appreciate the love. I appreciate all that. I'll see you in 50, 60 years, and thank you." No, folks, it's a lifelong journey. The shepherds returned to their sheep. The shepherds responded to the sign. The shepherds rejoiced in the Savior. And when we have encountered Jesus in our lives, our lives are changed. The carol says simply, "Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today." Folks, you have the greatest gift of Christmas if you're a born-again Christian. And I believe you are. We have an obligation like the shepherds. We came one day, I came to an old altar, and I came down and received Christ as my Savior. I asked Christ to come into my heart, and from that time on, I've shared Jesus with others. The Christmas is a time of sharing, as it was with the shepherds, as it was with Mary. Have you pondered Jesus in your heart enough to establish that foundation? And are you like the shepherds going away rejoicing and sharing the good news with others? That's the message of Christmas. Let's pray.
Hi, my name is John Blair, and I have the privilege of being the pastor here at Coventry Baptist Church in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I want to thank you for choosing to take part in our online services. I sincerely hope they were a blessing to you, and I want to invite you to continue to use them in the weeks yet ahead. In fact, take your time on our website, check it out, let us know what you think about it. Your opinion is very important to us, and we'd like to have some feedback. Let me take this time to also extend an invitation to you. If you don't already have a church home, let me invite you to come to our church and take part in one of our weekly services. Our morning worship service on Sunday is at 10 a.m. Our Sunday night service is at 6 p.m. And our Wednesday services and our midweek service is at 7 o'clock p.m. We're located at 10926 Aboit Center Road. We're right across the street from Homestead High School. Just get on our website. We have a detailed map and some instructions on how to get here. Again, thank you for choosing our website and our services. I pray that the Lord will bless you and keep you. I hope to see you this Sunday.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love.